expressing discontent and specified a bit better what I wanted to tell you. Okay, so more or less the plan of these two lectures is the following. I wanted to first to discuss a bit about the motivation, some of the problems from which that motivates some of the questions, the mathematical questions, then I later concentrate. And since, well, I was asked for introductory lectures for to the field, so we'll discuss basics about one of the tools I'm going to use in most of the rest of the two lectures. This optimal transport distance, Wasserstein distance, the distance between measures, and we will discuss later what it is. So that would be the second part. Discuss a bit. What is the here? Okay. What is what are the basic properties of this tool that we're going to use? And then I will concentrate on the on two models. One is a macroscopic equation. Let's say a first order model, as you will see later, a first order in the sense of derivatives in time. And then we will discuss a second order model, a kinetic model, with the very same tools. Okay, so let's go for it, and let's first start with the motivation. So let's talk about what is swarming, okay? So as usual, some pictures tells you much more than words, and what we want to discuss, or what we want to describe here, is the collective behavior of some animals that, well, somehow in they produce this kind of patterns. Let's say here, this, we see this school of fish producing this kind of nice rolling, milling behavior. And or here we see some birds, flocks, producing this kind of nice cloud of individuals moving up and down. Okay, so the idea is that what we would like to model is this collective behavior, the whole overall motion of the this large set of individuals, and this is more or less what is the definition of swarming. Swarming refers to the aggregations of agents of similar size and body type that generally move in a coordinated way. So this is something that has been observed in many species. I put fish, school, and bird flocks because they are the most attractive, and you can find it easily in the internet, but you find also a lot of them from insects, locusts, ants, bees, and mix of bacteria and microorganisms also develop this kind of behavior. And why is so interesting also from, it's also interesting from the point of view of control engineering. I mean, you want to mimic this behavior with robots. You would like to understand in some model that is able to describe this kind of motion, for instance, to control a manned vehicle operation. Okay, so most of the models here that I know, I am talking about the works of others, although I haven't included here many references, you have here a couple of them. Most of these models include three basic effects. And there are plenty of other effects, but these three basic effects are more or less always present. Essentially, you assume that these individuals are social. What do I mean by social? That they would like to be with others. So then there is some attraction effect that you want to include, some attraction region, and at least all of those individuals are attracted by you, or you are attracted by them. Okay? So, also you have an inner region, an inner core in which you don't feel comfortable if there is somebody else close to you. So you have a kind of a minimum inner repulsion effect, that you don't want to be other individuals close to you. And finally, there is another mechanism you want to include, and it has to be defined how you do this. It's the mechanism of alignment, or I would say mimicking. You try to mimic the behavior of others. You have to you want to follow the overall movement of others. So you have to define what you mean by this region of alignment, but the idea would be to include a mechanism of that sort. Okay? So these are the three basic effects you want to include in the model, in fact. And let me...
Can I ask you a question?
Yes, sure.
Why do the fish and the birds physically behave in this kind of
situation? Well, this is absolutely right. I mean, here we are assuming that these effects, you want to include them in the model. I mean, you see that it's possible that they follow, I mean, at least that they take into account somehow these effects, also others like collisional avoidance or others. But now the thing is how to model them, how to include them. I mean, of course, it's not clear at all that if I define certain rules for this, they will exactly follow that. I mean, that's another story, and it's very important also from, I mean, it's clear from the modeling point of view. In fact, to answer also to that question, I mean, there is a huge number of people of theoretical biologists working at the moment with these kind of models, trying exactly to, first, they are trying to see if they can reproduce the behavior. And essentially, with these three effects and many others, you can produce computations, numerical simulations, in which you don't see a difference between real bird flocks and the simulation that you see. And there is a group in the Netherlands doing that. This doesn't mean that they are doing the right model. It means that they are able to reproduce it with this kind of effects. Yeah. That's a different story. Now you have to, I mean, it's also important now, I mean, if... really how they behave, and that's difficult, and it's there are people who are studying that. In fact, in that picture, in that picture I show you here, these pictures are taken from an article produced by a group in group of physicists in Rome that have been studying the starlings flocks very carefully by taking well, in Circo Maximo in Rome, they take pictures all around to take 3D images of the flocks of birds and measuring distances and so on. And in fact, they have published very recently a paper saying a new theory, setting a new theory in which they say that the essential behavior of each bird in the flock is fixed by a certain final number amount of other neighbors. So it's a completely different model than the one I'm going to present. Okay? So what I mean is that there's a lot of study in that direction. It's really an interesting question.
And is there some benefit? I'm sorry, is there some benefit to the birds or to the fish to behave in this way? Is it for like hunting? Or
that's another way. That's another way of research. I mean, why do they do that? I mean, they do it for to move easily in the medium. I mean, because it's a more aerodynamic or inside the water, it's more aerodynamic
more
in a sense.
Energy efficient,
yeah, we could say that. Also because of abundance of predators, because in this way they don't see well they may pretend that it's a big fish instead of 100 million of small fish. Okay? So this kind of, yeah, there are studies also in that direction. Okay. Well, thank you very much for the question. Okay, so let me present you a couple of models in this direction that have been proposed recently. The first one is what I call a second order model to make a difference with respect to the first order model we present in the next slide. This is what we will call from a kinetic theory point of view a particle method or a particle system. In this community, they call these kind of things individual-based models, so an IBM model, since you see it in the literature. And Andrea Bertozzi, Dorsonia, Lincoln Chase, and other people at UCLA, including in this model, was very simple. let's make the simplest model that we can think of about an attraction and repulsion. So let's assume that we are given a potential, effective pairwise potential, which has an inner repulsive core with the choice of signs I make, and an attractive long distance, so long range attraction, short range of repulsion. You can, I will come back to that in a moment. And then they add, the only mimicking behavior, if you want, that they add, is that essentially these individuals want to move at the same speed asymptotically. So what you impose is a combination of two terms, one that they say that is motivated by a self-propulsion of the individuals, this alpha B, BI, and the other one which is a friction with in the medium in which they are moving, and as a balance of this self-propulsion and friction, you fix somehow asymptotically the speed. But you are not fixing, say, the velocity vector, okay? So it's a very simple model. You can cook up, as I said, the self-propulsion and friction fixes you an asymptotic speed. And you can cook up very easily potential like that by combining exponentially decaying functions of the radius with good choices of the constants that I'm putting there. In fact, with that choice, you have typically a shape like that. Okay? Good. Then it's quite funny, so it's very fun to do modal computations with this very simple model. And here, so here what you have is first the three typical patterns that you see by solving these equations. Oh, something happened. By solving these equations, it's very sensitive. By solving these equations with random initial data, say. That's the first line, which you see these three steady pictures. You have all the particles, and the arrows means the velocity vector scaling to see something. So what they are essentially going around all the time. So this what is called a median pattern. The second one, I have red arrows and blue arrows just to distinguish the one that go in the opposite direction. So you have like two families of particles, one that go in this direction and the other one that go in that direction, red ones. And then this is what is called a double mean pattern. And this one is everyone just moves in the same direction and follows that direction all the time, so translationally moving like this. This is what is called the flock pattern. And these kind of patterns, these three are the ones that you see typically you do random simulations of initial data with the basic model that I showed you before. These other three simulations that you have over here, they just, they are a bit small variations of the previous model in which you incorporate somehow, well, here there is no any variation. This is a double million in action, okay? And here what you have is a small variation of the previous model in which you impose that particles, they don't want to be very far away from the city, from the center. Say, this point, the origin is the city center, they don't want to be very far away from there, is their nest, say. Okay? And in this way we see, instead of a flock, we see a million flock. They turn around. What is interesting about all of this is that such a simple model leads you to these very complicated patterns. And what can you say about this? I mean, it would be interesting to say, well, I mean, are these patterns generic in some sense? What is the stability? A question of this sort. So still there are plenty of things to learn about this. And this was just, I will discuss that probably later in the conclusions if I have time, not to ask me. Okay, so good. So now I want to discuss about the first order model. So what is the, from where it comes the first order model? In fact, this was proposed in the literature much before the second order models. this is the first paper I know by the mathematical biologist community. It's by Lee Adlerstein, Cachet, and Molinar at the beginning of the 2000s. Although this model appears in many other places with for other applications, okay? But for this particular application, they discuss it in this way, essentially. You write the second order ODE for all particles, you have the friction here, and the pairwise potential. And you can assume, essentially, that the inertial time is negligible against all the others, and then you get to this first order gradient system for the particles. Okay? Well, so in particular, one interesting question in that for that first order model is what happens with, let's start with the Isis question in principle. What happens with the purely aggregation case? What happens when you have a purely a relative potential, say of the sort of potential that Andrea Bertozzi, D'Orsogna et al. Were using, so something like U of X, 1 minus E to the minus modulus of X. Okay? That would be, can you see it there? It's okay? Or is there a color shock, maybe? One minute right here, maybe. Let's try here. Is it better here?
Yes.
Okay, so so that's a potential of the type that I showed you before. It's attractive, and the problem that you have is that at the origin, you have a Lipschitz singularity. It behaves at the origin, it behaves like modulus of X. Okay? So in principle, I mean, that causes you some difficulties because the gradient of U is not the force. It's not going to be Lipschitz, so you don't have clearly defined characteristics, so you have to work here if you want to say something about that. Okay, so, and finally, let me give you another second-order model that has been quite in fashion in the last 3-4 years. It was introduced by Felipe Fulker and Steven Smale in the field more of control of artificial robots, in the field of control engineering. And it's a particle model in which you have only one effect included, this kind of mimicking behavior. Let's see how they do it. And what they propose to do is a very easy idea. You are assuming, although you assume a lot, you're assuming that each individual in the swarm is able to measure instantaneously its relative velocity with all the others. So the relative velocity is just Vj minus Vi. Okay? And now, the evolution of the velocity of that individual is going to follow at somehow its derivative in time is going to be a weighted average of those relative velocities. How the weights of that average are chosen, that's where it enters a bit more the idea of the swarm. The weights are going to be chosen in such a way that those individuals that are close to you, or are closer to you, they count more than those that are far from you. So how do you do that? So you assume that the weight is a function of the relative distance, and it's going to be a decreasing function of the relative distance. So it's going to be something like 1 over 1 plus the relative distance squared to a power. Why not? Okay? Just to choose something, in principle. So this was a model proposed by Cooper and Snail, and it's quite funny. It's not so easy to say what happens for the long-time asymptotics of this model. And, essentially now we know that this model, I mean the ODE system, produces what is called asymptotic flocking whenever gamma is less or equal than 1/2. What does it mean? Why is gamma less or equal than 1/2? If gamma is smaller, means that the people that are far from you count more, somehow, as gamma gets smaller. So essentially that you are able to see everybody with more strength. if Ghana is smaller. So what will happen, we will discuss that later. But essentially, there were a series of papers, one by Cooper and Strain, the original one, then Han Tatmore, Han Yang-Wu Liu, and myself, and my collaborators, for Francisco Toscani and Rosado, which we did several improvements over things that were done at the beginning by Cooper and Strain. But they had some conditional flocking results. They had that for certain initial data, they could prove asymptotic flocking. What it means asymptotic flocking? It means that the particle at the beginning will do something, but essentially as t goes to infinity, they will decide to move in one direction, and then they will flock into that direction. So what is the direction they choose? That's easy, because you can check quite quickly that due to the symmetry of the weights, the mean velocity is preserved. Just sum I, the equation for the dVIET. Then the right-hand side becomes zero by symmetrizing. So the mean velocity is the one that you choose. But you have to prove essentially that all velocities tends to the mean velocity when t goes to infinity, and that's not clear. Okay, so we will come back to that in the second part, okay? So the objective till now was just to give you somehow three examples of models that have been proposed in this field, and what are some of the questions, and what are some of the problems you want to describe. Okay, so now, more mathematical questions. So let's see. The first question is, from the point of view of the, to set up a good theory for deriving a continuum model. So the first question from my point of view is, what is the continuum model if I get larger and larger number of particles? That has a lot to do with kinetic theory, because it's one of the questions in kinetic theory, what happens when the number of particles get large. The second question is a bit more specific, if you want. Here we expect somehow that there is some concentration either of mass, concentration of mass, either on space or on velocity, that we want to measure how this happens, if it happens in finite, in infinite time. And for instance, in the first order model I wrote with a potential like that, which is just Lipschitz, think about, for instance, if you choose the easiest example, is choose modulus of x and in one dimension. And think about the equation d rho dt equals the derivative with respect to x of what? The sine of x on both with rho multiplied by rho. That would be a very interesting equation, as you will see in a moment, because it would, you will understand in a minute what I wrote this equation from the particle system. And if you want to think about the particle system xit minus what it would be sine of x convolved with the sum. Okay, now. Minus the sum j from 1 to n of the sine of x j minus xi, I think. That would be. Okay, that one. Okay? Think about this kind of system. Essentially, all the particles are moving with a constant speed, which is determining how many particles have to the left or how many particles have to the right. So you are doomed to have a collision between particles. So you have to deal with that if you want to include potentials like this. So the question also is really, what is the good analytical framework to deal with this possible concentration over here? If you want, just putting them together, what is the good analytical framework to deal with particles and continuous solution at the same time, if possible? And finally, question has more to do with my talk in the conference, but I announced it here. How to deal with the competition between diffusion and aggregation? Okay, I will not discuss today about diffusion. I will discuss it in the conference. Okay, so that's about more or less the introduction. Now I need some basics of the Bassel-Stein distance. Okay. Well, as I told you, I need some tool in order to deal with the possible concentration of my density as a measure, the possible concentration either in points in space or in velocity. So you need some way of measuring the distance between probability measures, and that is manageable for calculations and related to also to the PDEs. So one of these tools is these optimal transportation distances that had been also used in many other samples in the last 10 years, but I will not discuss too much on that, but going into the detail, how to define that distance. Okay, for defining this the so-called Bassel-Stein distance, between two probability measures. First, I need just a notation, which is how to transport one measure through a map. Okay, so I give them a measurable map. So I'm given two measures, mu and nu. I will say that mu is the transported measure of the map, of the measure mu through the map T, if essentially you the measure of any global set of respect to mu is obtained by measuring the Borel set image measure through the map T. Okay? But it's much easier to remember this definition. How the definition of a measure has functionals on the set of test functions, say continuous functions with limit 0 to infinity. So you just define your transported measure in this way. The action on mu on the test function is obtained by the action on mu on the test function composed with the map T. Okay? Well, this, for those of you that have also probability background, is exactly the same as image measure of a random variable. Okay? So the definition of a random variable somehow say that mu is the law of a random variable, is say that mu is the image measure of p through the map, through a random variable x. So essentially this definition that you have here is, which is again written over here, coincides with the standard definition of the expectation of phi of the random variable x. Okay? So this is just a notation for transporting measures or for doing the image measure through a map, as you prefer. Now let me say, let me try to explain in plain ideas or plain words what is going to be this distance. So the question you ask yourself is the following. I have two probability densities. I wrote them very nicely here with no concentration, so I'm assuming that I have here my two piles of, say, of sand. So I have two piles of sand. Well, it's better to think about this as a pile of sand and this as a hole in the ground, okay? And then what I want to do is to transport, I assume that the hole in the ground has the space for the same mass as I have here, so both they have the same mass, and I want to transport all the sand here to this ground, to this hole in the ground, okay? And I want to transport it to this hole with the minimum possible energy spent. So I have to define how to measure the energy. So let's assume that we are going to measure the energy needed to transport n kilograms of sand from a location x here to a location here, T of x, or location A to location B, by just the proportional to the distance, the square between the two points. Well, it's an assumption. We could do here any other exponent that you want. Let's assume it's just proportional to the square of the distance. So then, of course, you are going to have many ways, possibly, of transporting all the mass of row 1 to all the mass to row 2, to the hole. you are going to have many teas, but you want to find what is the optimal tea that does the job for you. So that is going to be the definition of the basis time distance between these two measures, a square. You obtain, you want to find among all possible ways of transporting the mass of row 1 to the mass of row 2, find the one that minimizes the total energy. Okay? So in principle, with this notation, you would like to find a T optimal that does the job for you, transport the row 1 to the row 2, and minimizes between all the T's possible, and that would be the definition of the mass of time distance. Okay? The problem with this definition is that here I'm doing this with very nice measures, so with functions essentially. Let's say integral function with integral 1. But assume that I have a real measure which has a non-zero singular part, or say a non-zero atomic part, then I will have an atom here. If I have an atom here, I cannot do a map. Because I will be forced to sum all the mass of the atom that is at the position x to some part here. And I don't, in my number here, I don't have atoms. So I will not have the possibility to do that. So then you have to allow for splitting the mass. So you have to allow for being able to sum from the same location x to different locations y over here some little bit of mass, in order that you are able to give the mass to everyone according to the law. Okay? So that's why you need this more general definition of the basis time distance, to allow real general measures and not only L1 densities. So in fact, I do the definition now with a power P. I'm going to use essentially either P equals 1 or 2. It refers to how we define the energy that we spend, either the quadratic cost or just the Euclidean distance. And now the definition is the following. The total energy that you spend is defined by what is called a transference plan. This pi xy now becomes a probability measure in the product space, Rd cross Rd. And it gives you the probability that you're going to send, well, it gives you the mass that you're going to send from x to y. Okay? So this means that if I integrate in y, I have rho 1 of x, or my measure mu, the first measure that from which I'm computing the distance. And if I iterate in x, that would be the target density, I will have the measure mu. So this pi xy has to have marginals mu and mu. And between all possible ways of sending this mass, the mass of mu to the mass of mu, I minimize the total energy. Well, this is a way of, say, somehow relaxing the variational problem that they had before. Now the pi xy don't have to be concentrated on a graph of a function t. And now this infimum, in fact, is well-defined, is achieved, is in fact a minimum in general for any measure. Now, okay, let me also write the definition of the distance for those that come from probability background, in terms of expectations, because it's a nice way to remember too. In fact, what you do is you take any pair of random variables such that x has low mu and y has low mu, and you minimize the expectation of x minus y to the p. When I take a pair of random variables, this means that I take any possible distribution for the pair, and I am fixing only the distribution of the marginals. Okay, it's exactly the same. So, and now you see that this is a relaxed variational scheme with respect to the previous one, with respect to the one that I used in the previous slide, because if you choose as a transference plan this given a map T, you choose this transference plan as in the definition here, as pi, then you recover exactly the integral of x minus tx to the p. Well, this is a bit complicated map to see, but this means the product map. Okay, anyhow, it's not difficult to see that this generalizes exactly variation I've seen before by choosing particular pies. Good. So now we have defined this distance. Okay. So now what is this distance useful to us? What are the properties of that distance? Well, before that, I have another nice slide about two simple examples of the computation of the distance to understand a bit about it. What's the distance between two delta Vx? So it's exactly what you would expect. If I ask you the distance between two delta Vx, it should be somehow the distance between the panels, no? So this is what it is, modulus of A minus B. This is a good point to say something. I mean, you know other norm for measures, total variation. Total variation is not good. Total variation between delta A and delta B is how much? It's 2. So it doesn't distinguish where they are. Okay? So the delta moving with a trajectory will be continuous with the Bassel's time distance and not with total variation. Okay, so that's a nice property. Another simple computation of this distance, what is the distance from a density to a delta Dirac? So it's nothing else, I mean, it's very easy, because what I didn't mention why is that the result. I mean, it's easy because if you think in terms of optimal transportation, you have to send all the mass of A to the mass of B, you don't have other possibilities. And here the same, you have to send all the mass of rho to the only single point. So by thinking that this is the optimal map, this is what you get. I mean, it's just the second moment of rho center at the point x equal. Okay? So these are simple samples of the computation of that distance. Now, some properties that makes this distance useful. What is the notion of convergence? A sequence of measures converges to a limit in the Bassel's time distance 2. If this is equivalent to say that you have weak star convergence as measures, okay, plus convergence of the second moment. Okay, so the difference with respect to weak star convergence is that you need also the convergence of as many moments that you have in the index. Okay, all moments up to order 2, less or equal than 2, have to converge to the limit. Or if you want, you are able to multiply by test functions that goes at most quadratically at infinity. You have a good property also in terms of continuity when you want to show when you want to use variational arguments. It's very useful to have with lower semi-continuity, and you have it in both indices, in both arguments of the distance. So you have a property like that. And finally, if you take the set of probability measures with the second moment bounded, and you consider in that space the Bassel's time distance too, it produces a complete metric space. So it's a way of working with measures as a metric space with a good definition with the good distance. Good. What else? The last property I want to mention to you, I don't know if I'm going to use it today, we should have skipped it, but it's just that in one dimension, the Bassel's time distance has a nice expression. So many times in one dimension, you can work at this formally do computations with this trick. As you know, probability densities in one dimension are equivalent to distribution functions. So what you can do is to write the Bassel's time distance in terms of the inverse of the distribution function. Since the distribution function is just a non-decreasing function, then the inverse is not always completely well-defined. You have to define what is called the pseudo inverse. When you define it in that way, essentially the idea is the same. You're going to do the symmetrization with respect to the straight line y equals x. That's it. This is what you get if it's just non-decreasing. And then, with the cylinders, you can write much better the Bassel's time distance. In fact, you can start by seeing that the inverse distribution function is a way of defining a random variable with a low exactly mu, and that transports the Lebesgue measure to mu. This is just by definition and change of paradigms. But this is not too important. The important thing is, don't try to read that. The important thing is that the Bassistine distance in one dimension, you can write it in terms of the inverse of the distribution functions associated to the two measures. So f minus 1 is the one associated to mu, g minus 1 is the one associated to mu. The Bassistine distance p, for any p between 1 and infinity not included, is just the np norm of the difference. So this allows you in one dimension to do many computations, at least formally. Then you have to work to make them correct, because so the inverse has this problem with the, as we mentioned before. Okay, anyhow, so I think with this I made a brief summary of some of the properties of the Bassistine distance that will be helpful to understand what I'm going to say later. Okay? Good. So now let's come back to, after this little digression on Bassistine distance, let's come back to some of the models I mentioned at the beginning. And let's start with the first order model. Okay? So let's then fix ideas. Let's assume that we have a given potential. But I'm going to assume with a loss of generality that, I'm going to assume that it's not singular from the very beginning, just continuous. I'm going to assume that at 0 bar is equal to 0, I can change it by a constant, and I can assume also that it's symmetric. Okay? So essentially, as we saw in the first models I showed you, the first order model with particles is nothing else than a gradient flow of this n-dimensional volume flow of the potential u. So essentially that xi dot, this minus sum, mj is the mass of the particle j, say, and here you have the gradient u xi minus xi. So essentially in this way you have, this is a picture for the attraction from location A that you produce onto another location. And what you want to, the first question we would like to solve, as we said before, is how to write a continuum model associated to that, and how to deal with this passage from particles to model, to continuum model, and so on. Okay, so to guess what is the continuum model is quite easy. I already somehow unveiled it before here, but here we are just saying essentially that the velocity field of the particle location I should be obtained in this way, by averaging all the attraction that any other particle located at position xa produces on xi. So this is exactly what I'm going to do if I have a continuum density. Let's assume I have a continuum density at time t or xt. So the velocity field I can assume at location x is obtained by averaging all the attraction or repulsion effect that mass rho of y at location y produces on a location x. Okay? So I average that, I get the velocity field. And then what essentially my model I expect to be is it's going to be a continuity equation where the velocity field is given by this minus gradient combined with rho. Okay? Well, because, I mean, essentially, the characteristics of this will correspond exactly to the particle system. So somehow, this is a simple guess that this is going to be the right continuous one. Remember that I have all the time in mind this particular case of the most potential. Okay? So in fact, I would like to concentrate first in the particular case in which the potential is just attractive, as I told you. Let's try to discuss first just attractive potential. Okay, so just to fix ideas again now, that's the model, the continuous model I expect, the continuity equation with the velocity field given by minus gradient u with rho. I assume that essentially this is producing an attractive potential. And let's assume that this is the typical 1 minus e to the minus modulus of x. So now the question also that I would like to discuss is, for which of these attractive potentials, say, do we get finite time blowup? Let's come back to this discussion I did before here on the map, or I probably should have done it now at this moment. I come back here again. Take a potential equals modulus of x in one dimension. This is the particle system, and that's the continuity equation, as you see. Just think about the particle system. If I want this to pass to a limit when n goes to infinity, better I should put that all the masses are equal and they sum up to 1. So I should put, in fact, that 1 over m here, because that's the mass that corresponds to each location. So now you see better than this when n goes to infinity, well, somehow should go to an equation like that. But nevertheless, think about this. You see that the velocity field at each location, xi, is essentially constant. It's just the number of particles that are to the left minus the number of particles that are to the right, or vice versa. Okay? It depends on the sign. I will make a set sign error, sign mistake. This is what it is. And essentially, in the two particles that are the farthest away, to the left or to the right, in one, in the farthest away to the right, is minus 1, because all particles are to the left. And in the farthest away to the left, since all particles are to the right, is 1. And it's constant, minus 1 and 1. So essentially, in finite time, they are forced to collide. Okay? So in fact, we need to deal with this possibility. So let's try, let's see how we can deal with that. And for that, the Rosenthal distance, again, is going to be a useful tool. So the first basic property of the equation, I should draw the equation somewhere. Is the continuity equation with the velocity field given by minus the gradient of the potential converted. Okay? So in fact, it's not difficult to see that you have formal conservation of the center of mass. This is just by the symmetry of the gradient of u. Let me not do more detail on that. And now I want to concentrate more in this sentence I have there. In fact, what happens with this model is that you can give it a sense as a gradient flow, and you can give it a sense as a gradient flow of an energy function on the set of measures. Here I wrote it in terms of L1 functions, but easily you can write it in terms of measures, which is the total potential energy. And it's a gradient flow with respect to the Wasserstein distance. Well, I have to explain you what it means this. Well, this notion of gradient flow with respect to Wasserstein distance is something that was introduced by Felix Otto for the Porus minimum equation at the beginning of the 2000, and since then it has been used for many equations, including equations of that form, okay? Essentially, when the U is smooth. A smooth means, for me, single, at least. Well, in fact, C2, to have a some greater convergence to it. But, well, my typical case is not regular. Now I have to explain you a bit what it means that this is a gradient flow. Of course, to explain it in full detail, this will lead to a full course of many hours, well, at least 5. But I want to give you just the formal, the intuitive idea behind that. First, that the continuity equation, in fact, you can write it easily as the following, it has the following structure. The velocity field is, in fact, minus the gradient of the variational derivative of that functional with respect to rho. So if you take the total potential energy, you compute its formal variational derivative, you see that the Saturn equation has this structure. So it has the structure of a continuity equation where the velocity field is given by minus the gradient of that. In this way, you see clearly that this is going to be a good Lyapunov function. Well, this is going to be a Lyapunov function. Because, I mean, just do the formal computation, the derivative in time of this rho t will give you the variational derivative of the function multiplied by d rho dt. You substitute d rho dt, you iterate by parts once, and you get that. Nothing else. At least formally, you should have this entropy dissipation for that. So in fact, this is the then the right function after this iteration, and it should lead to some information also about the asymptotic behavior, because it gives you a good form of the dissipation. Okay, so in order to give you an idea of why this is useful, I'm going to show you the first two slides and then we'll do the break. Okay? So this is a very elementary slide. I promise it's the most elementary that I could show today. Now, apart from the one with the pictures. Okay, so I call it the sliding down in an energy landscape. Okay, so we have a given energy function. Let's assume that we are in Rn. We have a given energy function E of x. So a gradient flow in Rd is just given by this OD system. Very good. What is, if you want, is the continuous version of the steepest descent on the energy landscape determined by E, which is nothing else than implicit Euler scheme. Okay, the implicit Euler scheme means that for a given time step delta t, and a given approximation of this x of t at location at time tk, k delta t, we will find the approximation at time tk plus 1 by solving that. From where comes the implicit order discretization? The implicit order discretization, it comes essentially from solving the forward variational problem. What you do is you minimize 1 2 over 2 delta t, the distance x minus xk squared plus e of x, and you minimize in x under certain assumptions on e. The points, I mean, for sure, if there is some minimum, it will be a critical point, and then we will satisfy that, but for certain assumptions, say convexity, we will have a really a solution of that variational problem, and it will be determined by solving that equation. Okay? So, we can say that, I mean, in some sense, this is a gradient flow because it comes from the continuum version of the implicit order schemes that, well, you solved using this kind of variational formulation. You do this steepest descent with the Euclidean distance of the function of t. So this is exactly the real sense of giving to that equation the notion of the structure of gradient flow with respect to Wasserstein distance. So in fact, what Jordan Kinder and Otto proposed, that was for the linear Fokker-Planck equation, was to solve the linear Fokker-Planck equation by a variational scheme, which is somehow the one that I'm showing you here. What you do is you solve, like in the implicit order scheme, and you do a steepest descent, but now with the Wasserstein distance. So here, rho k is a measure, okay? So you are given a measure, rho k, which is your initial step at time tk, and now, you minimize over all possible measures with the same center of mass. That's why you have this zero over here. You minimize the distance square of rho to rho k with the factor 1 over 2 delta t, penalized by the energy function. So, well, Jordan, Kinder, and Arotto proved, in fact, that as then constructing this variational scheme, doing certain interpolation in time of the measures, you can pass to a limit as delta t goes to zero under certain conditions, and you converge to a weak form of the continuity equation where the velocity field is in fact given by where you converge with rho, in my case. In this, then in general you will converge to manage volume of the variational derivative of E with respect to rho. By using the one I have, which is the potential energy, you will converge to something like that. I mean, in principle, this is, again, it's a formal argument that this leads always to that. For particular ease, this was known. For the particular function I have, which is the total potential energy, for that one, it was known for smooth U, okay? Say UC2. Or even it could be done by using the theory of Ambrosio, Lilly, and Savarello in the recent book of linear ferromagnetic spaces, you arrive to smooth C1 potentials with a most quadratic growth at infinity with that theory. Okay, but remember I want to include things which are not, which are Nietzsche's somehow. And you have this problem also of concentration. Look, so this is the rigorous way of setting that this equation, this first order model, is a gradient flow of that function of the total potential energy with respect to Wasserstein. Okay? I will not, of course, give you the details of the proof of this in my case, but I will give you some hints of why this is useful and how to use this to get some qualitative properties. Okay? And this is the right point, I think, to stop and have the break. Thank you.